Before we get into this episode, I want to thank our sponsors. We just keep adding to the list, and I'm so honored and humbled by that. I appreciate people's support. I want to start off with our local folks here in the Houston area, Conroe, Texas. The name of the company is Summer Moon Coffee, and friends of our family has started this coffee shop, and I want to thank Wyatt and his team for taking care of the community and for serving and just providing great product, great atmosphere. Summer Moon Coffee in Conroe. Also, a good friend of mine, veteran, U.S. Army veteran and man of faith, Randy LeVere in Indiana, who started a company called Armored Nation Coffee. And he has provided us with opportunities for savings. If you type in last in line, when you go to his website, armoredcoffee.com, you'll get a 25% discount on the greatest coffee to date that I've seen and tasted from the great state of Indiana. Let's put it that way. It's very good. Very good. And he's a great guy. And the mission he has is to take the gospel to the marketplace. So thank you, Armored Nation Coffee. Also, Do Work That Matters is a fairly new sponsor, a young man who is out showing appreciation with an apparel line that he's created for first responders, people in the community that serve, give back, and do work that matters. He's created a clothing line. He's been gracious with giving us some of his merchandise, and it's great stuff. Love the logo. So thank you to Do Work That Matters. Most recently, we've added the Cowboy Revolution Apparel Company, and I came across him on Instagram and just reached out, and we connected, and he was nice enough to send us some things, and love the logo, love his brand, and Cowboy Revolution Apparel is our newest sponsor. So I say go check them out on Instagram and go to their website and cowboyrevolutionapparel.com and get some of their stuff. It's awesome. Worthy mission. So want to thank our sponsors for their support. Hey, look, we've all had stuff happen to us. We've all been in situations where we felt behind the eight ball on something, or either we caused some sort of hardship on somebody else, or we were the victim of just a tragedy, or just at the very basic level, you know, we've been on the wrong side of a situation, and we start looking kind of as to why did things happen. We ask ourselves, you know, why me? We get into that trap, and then, you know, some of us even have blamed God or been mad at God before, or we blame a lot of other people, external factors. But, you know, we've all been in that situation where things just haven't gone the way we thought, and it was very disappointing. It was debilitating. It was depressing. And, you know, we have some initial reactions that we go through. We've got some processes that are chemical, and I won't get into all the pathophysiology of why we react and why our brain does what it does. But you guys know, when you're going through a situation, there's ways you react. You know, there's that fight or flight. There's that we get angry, or we, you know, we get defensive, or we just turn away and want to be alone, or we get very emotional, or, you know, some of us turn to other outlets possibly. But I want to talk to you today about getting over your under. And that's what I want to call it today, because I believe there's three unders that we are faced with sometimes whenever adversity hits, when tragedy strikes, when we are up against it. So what happens when things happen? I mean, I say, you know, like I said before, we kind of, our initial reactions, and there's many, but we ask why we kind of have a pity party occasionally. Like if we start to sink into that pit of despair, we start to feel sorry for ourselves, and we've all done it. And so I think that there's a metaphor I want to use in athletics, and I typically use sports because I believe sports can show us many things, teach us many things, many lessons to be learned in real life from sports, just because of all that is involved. So much adversity, so much training, so much hardship, so much victory, defeat, how to handle things. So if you think about winning athletes, like I'll give you three sports that came to mind just because I'm talking about you know, when we get hit with something, what do we do? And so rather than asking so many questions, rhetorical questions about why, you know, this happened and poor me type stuff, I believe, I mean, in boxing, they have what's called stick and move, right? They hit and move so the other guy can't hit them. So they're moving constantly. Football's got the bump and run. If you're familiar with defense, you know how defensive backs, they've got to cover a guy and go wherever he goes and mirror that guy, be his shadow. But they'll bump him at first to kind of knock him off of his track just so they can sort of get a leg up on whatever route he's running so they can stay with him, right? Basketball's got the pick and roll. You got a guy that's just kind of standing there and creating a shield, and guys run into him all the time, but they got to break through or dodge that pick and roll sometimes to get the play executed. But in all three of those examples, if you think about it, each require contact. Each require, in boxing, this is literal, but proverbial punch in the mouth before you actually can execute the game plan. But they all require collision of some kind, right? So in our lives, victory most likely can't come without some sort of collision emotionally, psychologically, relationally, financially, relationally. Like, we all have our version of what a collision looks like. We all have that initial contact that may stop us in our tracks or knock us backwards or knock us down ultimately. We know how this works. Life isn't smooth. Most of the time it's rocky terrain, right? But I'm here to tell you today, there's different kinds of unders that we can get over. So that's why I'm calling it getting over your under. So three types of those, but I wanted to set the stage because I think you guys know where I'm coming from, and you might be in a situation right now that is requiring you to stick and move a little bit, to bump and run, right? You're getting a pick thrown at you. You got to pick and roll. So you got to get around some of these obstacles. And I think we're all in that. I mean, I'm in a version of that. When you're in a job that you don't feel called to, but you know it pays the bills and you're trying to be faithful with what God's given you in that moment, like, that's a season. And a season could be years. That's what I struggle with. God's season might be different than my season. And I don't always quite get the timing of things, but that's why he's perfect and in charge. And that's why I follow him, because my timing's wrong a lot of time. So in my life, if I'm in a job that I don't feel called to, or it's not like, it doesn't energize me, right? It doesn't stimulate. And I'm not looking to feel good every time I go to work every day. I don't need to feel like the clouds part and angels sing every morning I go to work. But what I'm saying is, I feel called to something different, something bigger, something more in line with my gifts. And so that, I'm just using that as an example, because I believe I'm in a place of maybe sticking and moving a little bit, because every day is a challenge to press through and go do my work at 100% and try to maintain some level of passion while I do it. That's a challenge. And I guarantee somebody listening to this is right in that same space. So the three types of unders, okay, I'm going to give you a couple. One's going to be, this first category is going to be sort of external. The next one will be internal. And then I've got a breakthrough for you, because this would all be pointless for me to tell you and diagnose the symptoms, but not give you the treatment for those symptoms or whatever that disease is that's causing you to be stuck in your tracks or knocked backwards on your journey. So the three unders I've got for you, the first one's external. It's going to be under attack. So that's external, right? Under attack. We all know what that is. That could be, I mean, that could be a boss. That could be a spouse. You know, you could feel under attack, with your children, really, if you're feeling like you're raising teenagers and you're up against all the social obstacles that are out there, social media, school, different things, them wanting to be cool, whatever it is. And you're in opposition of that, but you're kind of fighting against your child in that situation. So you feel under attack as the parent even. And with the spouse, I mean, obviously, if you guys are not like-minded, or if you're constantly bickering, if there's no intimacy, if you're not serving each other, and if both parties aren't 100% in, not 50-50, 100 and 100. If both parties aren't there, then there can be a feeling of being under attacked. So those are the external kind of factors I'm talking about. But, you know, what do we do in that situation? So I'm going to go through kind of what we do and what happens on each of these. And what we do, obviously, when it's an external situation, we internalize that, right? The challenge, obstacle, or opposition may not be internal, but the external force actually causes us to internalize it to a point of it really gets knit into the fabric of our psyche. It becomes like intertwined within our emotional framework. And there's so much collateral damage from that. Like that manifests in so many other areas when we do that. So we shut in and we shut down sometimes, right? So when we internalize it, I feel like that is only covering up a wound that just festers and gets infected and creates other issues systemically within us and within our lives, in our sphere of influence around us. So that's what we do whenever we are under attack. Like we internalize and then it kind of seeps into our psyche. Well, so what happens there? Well, it when we start doing that, it starts sinking in and we start burying it and stuffing it down. Like it feeds that insecurity that we've always had. And we all have it. You will not, I don't care how successful you are. You can't tell me you don't have one insecurity. I mean, Bill Gates has got an insecurity. In fact, sometimes the level of success is almost overcompensating for something else. The driven guy, not always, but sometimes the overdriven, hyper energetic guy that's out chasing status, money, title, fame, whatever, the celebrity, is kind of overcompensating for something underneath, right? And I don't know what that is. I'm not a psychologist, but I'm telling you, everybody deals with an insecurity. So when we internalize, it feeds that. It just stokes that fire of our insecurity. And you know what happens there? We start going to other outlets that make us feel less insecure. We start looking at the wrong places on the internet. We start having those inappropriate conversations at work with the opposite sex. We start talking to our wives differently. We start, you know, stop going to church, stop reading our Bible. It kind of manifests in other outlets. Whenever we start stuffing stuff in, we start, you know, just doing the things that maybe take us away or off course. So, you know, what else happens? Well, it reminds us of the past sometimes. So if you're under attack externally, you know, from an external force and you're that insecurity is getting fed and it's fueled and then there's a fire going on that. And then you start drudging up old memories of things you did wrong, of ways you failed. You start bringing up old things from your childhood that were maybe not so pleasant. And you start living in that dark memory. And so you can sort of see this snowball, right? You can feel it as I'm saying it out loud. I can feel sort of that sick toxicity within me. If that's happening to you and it's happened to me too, like you can sort of feel it well up in you. So being insecure and then thinking of the past failures and all the darkness that you've overcome potentially, we start to isolate. That's the last thing that happens. And there's a lot of things that happen, but I'm just hitting on a couple. So we isolate. I mentioned earlier, we shut in and shut down. There's no greater tactic of the enemy. The devil loves to isolate men of God, men of faith, guys that are going to church, guys that are serving, guys that are leading. The enemy loves nothing more than to isolate. You've watched National Geographic enough to know, right? I grew up in the 80s. I watched Wild Kingdom. If you don't know what that is, Google it. But you know, we're watching National Geographic and we see, right? The cheetah will isolate the gazelle. He will push him away from the pack, right? That gazelle's not anything without a pack. And so if we do that, guess who's coming for us? We self-internalize or self-isolate. And then all of a sudden the things start to manifest that I mentioned earlier, the sin, the darkness, the just depravity, whatever it is, it starts to take over. So that's what happens in the external situation. So when you're under attack, that's the first under attack. Second one is underestimated. Guess who's underestimating you? Well, this is internal, right? The internal person underestimating you is you. So we've got external, we got internal. The internal under is the underestimated. So if we're getting over our unders here, we got to get over underestimating ourselves. You're raising your hand, you're nodding your head right now. You're saying out loud, yep, I've done it. Especially if you're alone in the car and you don't want anybody to know about it, you're admitting some things you wouldn't ordinarily admit if you're like me. So yeah, we've all done it. So what do? Well, we sell our potential short. That's how we're underestimating. We sell ourselves short, and whatever potential we have, it never gets fully realized. Because why? Because we're underestimating our capability. We're underestimating maybe our talent, our gifts, our fortitude. You know, sometimes when you're forced into survival mode, you start realizing things about yourself you never knew were there. You start to realize, I'm a little more resilient than I thought. When I'm out in the cold for any length of time, on paper, I'm looking at that going, I would never spend an hour outside when it's 20 degrees, never. But if I'm outside and I have to, let's say the car won't start, and I'm trying to either fix a flat or I'm jumping a car or whatever I'm doing, and I'm out there for an hour in 20 degree weather, I'm not thinking about that. So guess what? I just looked up and I've been out in that 20 degrees for an hour and didn't realize I could actually do it. We have a lot of those things in our lives where you're facing some things that look intimidating or overwhelming, insurmountable maybe, and you're talking yourself out of it. You're not giving yourself enough credit. You're underestimating your resilience, your capability, right? We got a lot more in the tank than we ever thought we did. When our gas tank is on E, right, in the car, we know there's still about 20 miles left, 30 miles left, right? The E is not a true E, just the same as us. When we're feeling like we're on E and we're on fumes, we got a little left in the tank. So, you know, so we sell ourselves short. We sell our potential short. That's what we do when we underestimate. And we start, you know, our anthem becomes this, all we'll ever get is all we've ever done and is all we'll ever be, right? It's kind of like this is as good as it's going to get. And that's our lineage curse that we start to relive in our head. My dad, you know, that was as good as he ever did. That's as good as I'll ever do. That's probably as good as my kids will ever, you know. This is where we talk ourselves, we cap ourselves. And so that's part of the underestimate. And we, of course, we disqualify ourselves. Well, I can't do that. You know, I'm not even going to try for that promotion because I don't even think I could do that job. Even though you've been given plenty of gifts, God's wired you to win, really. Ultimately, he's wired us to win, to be good. He wants Christians to win because that just builds our testimony. That builds us. If we're giving glory to him, that's just a reflection of his goodness. So then he wants people to see that around us. So disqualifying ourselves almost, it takes the keys out of his hands. And we're driving the bus all of a sudden. But if you allow yourself to step into that, then watch God work. And then people around you will see it. And then we turn around and point to him. That's the ultimate goal. But that's the other one under, you know, what we do when we underestimate. And then what happens, of course, is we stop taking those risks, right? We fall short of a purpose that potentially could be ours. And when we fall short, we're in the mode of what could have been, what would have happened if, I wonder if I could have pulled that off. We start questioning ourselves again, right? Which is how we got in this situation to the beginning of this podcast when I said, why me? When stuff happens, we're all, why me? So in this case, we start going through the what ifs and what if I'd have tried that? So we fall short, not even realizing what our purpose could actually be. So when we get into an internal quicksand of underestimation of our abilities, talents, our potential, our purpose. We disqualify. We stop taking risks, right? Ultimately, we probably start getting around the right people that can speak into our lives and encourage, and that we can sort of learn from, and we see what good looks like and we strive for that. That's kind of a second, an afterthought on this, what happens, but those are some things. So there's two for you. External was under attack. Internal was underestimated, right? And then the final one is understand. This is where the breakthrough happens. When you can fully understand what you were called for, called to be, called to, who you were called to lead, love, what your legacy, understand what that is. So let's understand our capabilities first. And it's not in our own strength or superiority or talent or intelligence. If you're people of faith, there's plenty of scripture that talk about how you were created in God's image, right? You were created to do good works that he prepared beforehand. We're his workmanship that he prepared beforehand, right? So that we can walk in them. We're created his workmanship, right? That he created beforehand. So that tells me that we're capable, and God already knew. He's not surprised about anything that we encounter. So let's push forward and use those capabilities, because he's already said that we should walk in them. There's plenty of those. We're more than conquerors, right? That's a scripture. So, I mean, I think it's Romans 8:37 maybe, but look it up. More than conquerors, right? That lends itself to we're fully capable. The second one under breakthrough. So this is your breakthrough, guys. This is it right here. We've talked about all these other external, internal, these attacks, these insecurities, but this is our breakthrough. So the second one is our mission. So we got our capabilities. Now we got our mission. So don't forget what you're here to do. And there could be missions within missions. Trust me. It's not a one shot, you're done. But And there's really not a destination, to be honest. So what's your mission, right? Love your family, lead your family, love your wife, lead your family spiritually, provide for them, right? Protect them, get yourself in a place physically where you can actually take care of some things and take care of people. A mission is go live as much of the gospel as you can. Go try to be as close to Jesus as you can. No one will ever get there, but the Bible says that people will know that we're his disciples by the way we love people, the way we serve people, right? I'll add even the way we lead, servant leadership. So understand your mission. So first your capabilities, then your mission. Finally, understand, and I said it a minute ago, the legacy, okay? And we're all talking about it. Of course, everybody's talking about the L word. Right? The L word. Well, it used to be L word was love. Nobody wanted to say the L word, and everybody wanted to just kind of gloss over and just throw it out there and really not live it. So now the L word is legacy. Everybody's trying to talk about, oh, a legacy. Ooh, I want to leave a legacy. Ooh, I want to leave. Yeah, we do. But let's stop talking about it. Okay. We can leave a legacy right now, today, like part of my legacy. We build on that. It's not a get to the end, look back and go, here you go. There's my legacy. Here it is in an envelope. Here it is on a piece of paper. You know, it's today is part of it. Tomorrow's part of it. And what am I doing with that? We're stocking up, right? We're stacking these memories. We're stacking this legacy day by day, really moment by moment in the day, within the day. But if you understand your capabilities, you understand your mission, you'll understand that the legacy is happening right before you, right under your nose. So we got to grab a hold of it. We got to take it now. And we've got to, we can't let a moment slip us by. And so that's what I want to talk to you. And that's what I hope came across today was, look, things happen. It's not a why me pity party, right? There's certain things we can do. We can stick and move, bump and run, pick and roll. We get out of that situation. Yeah, we take on some heat. Yeah, we take on some opposition, some impact, some collision, some contact, but then we move forward. We go beyond that. We don't just stop there, right? As Rocky Balboa, the great theologian, once said, I didn't hear a bell yet. you know, when he gets knocked down, he said, I didn't hear no bell. So he ain't done. So we haven't heard a bell yet either. So while we're still breathing, we move through adversity. We take those punches and we move on. And we've got the three unders, right? We've got the under attack, the underestimated, and the understand. Get it, man. Get on, grab onto this. Under attack, know what you do and know how to battle some of this insecurity that happens within us, shutting in, the isolation. Just defend against that. So the internal, what do we, you know, what do we do is the potential gets sold short and we start disqualifying ourselves. So then we start stop taking risks and we start we fall short of the purpose ultimately. And so the final one's the breakthrough, capabilities, mission, and legacy. Understand those and watch what God does. Till next time, be blessed.